The Kadambas were an ancient royal family of Karnataka, India, that ruled northern Karnataka and the Konkan from Banavasi in present-day Uttara Kannada district. The kingdom was founded by Mayurasharma in circa 345, and at later times showed the potential of developing into imperial proportions. An indication of their imperial ambitions is provided by the titles and epithets assumed by its rulers, and the marital relations they kept with other kingdoms and empires, such as the Vakatakas and Guptas of northern India. Mayurasharma defeated the armies of the Pallavas of Kanchi possibly with the help of some native tribes and claimed sovereignty. The Kadamba power reached its peak during the rule of Kakusthavarma. The Kadambas were contemporaries of the Western Ganga dynasty and together they formed the earliest native kingdoms to rule the land with autonomy. From the mid-6th century the dynasty continued to rule as a vassal of larger Kannada empires, the Chalukya and the Rashtrakuta empires for over 500 years during which time they branched into minor dynasties. Notable among these are the Kadambas of Goa, the Kadambas of Halasi and the Kadambas of Hangal. During the pre-Kadamba era the ruling families that controlled the Karnataka region, the Mauryas and later the Satavahanas, were not natives of the region and therefore the nucleus of power resided outside present-day Karnataka. The Kadambas were the first indigenous dynasty to use Kannada, the language of the soil at an administrative level. In the history of Karnataka, this era serves as a broad-based historical starting point in the study of the development of region as an enduring geopolitical entity and Kannada as an important regional language. History. Origin. There are several legends regarding the origin of the Kadambas. According to one such legend, the originator of this dynasty was a three-eyed four-armed warrior called Trilokana Kadamba who emerged from the sweat of the god Shiva under a Kadamba tree. Another legend tries to simplify it by claiming Mayurasharma himself was born to Shiva and Budivi. Other legends tie them without any substance to the Nagas and the Nandas of northern India. An inscription of circa 1189 claims that Kadamba Rudra, the founder of the kingdom, was born in a forest of Kadamba trees. As he had peacock feather-like reflections on his limbs, he was called Mayurvarman. From the Talaganda inscription, one more legend informs that the founding king of the dynasty, Mayurasharma, was anointed by the six-faced god of war Skanda. Historians are divided on the issue of the geographical origin of the Kadambas, whether they were of local origin or earlier immigrants from northern India. The social order of the Kadamba family is also an issue of debate, whether the founders of the kingdom belong to the Brahmin caste as described by the Talaganda inscription, or of local tribal origin. Historians Chopra et al. Claim the Kadambas were none other than the Kadambu tribe who were in conflict with the Chera kingdom during the Songhom era. The Kadambas find mention in the Songhom literature as totemic worshippers of the Kadambu tree and the Hindu god Subramanya. According to R. N. Nandi, since the inscription states the family got its name by tending to the totem tree that bore the beautiful Kadamba flowers, it is an indication of their tribal origin. However, the historian Sastri and Kamat claim the family belonged to the Brahmin caste, believed in the Vedas and performed Vedic sacrifices. According to the Talaganda and the Gudnapur inscriptions, they belonged to the Manavya Gotra and were Haritiputras, which connected them to the native Shutus of Banavasi, a vassal of the Satavahana Empire. According to Rao and Minahan, being native Kannadigas, the Kadambas promptly gave administrative and political importance to their language Kannada after coming to power. Birth of Kingdom. One of their earliest inscriptions, the Talaganda inscription of Crown Prince Santivarma, gives what may be the most possible cause for the emergence of the Kadamba kingdom. It states that Mayurasharma was a native of Talaganda, and his family got its name from the Kadamba tree that grew near his home. The inscription narrates how Mayurasharma proceeded to Kanchi in circa 345 along with his guru and grandfather Veerasharma to pursue his Vedic studies at Agataka. There, owing to some misunderstanding between him and a Pallava guard or at an Ashvasanstha, a quarrel arose in which Mayurasharma was humiliated. Enraged, the Brahmin discontinued his studies, left Kanchi swearing vengeance on the Pallavas and took to arms. He collected a faithful group of followers and routed the Pallava armies near the Srisalam region. After a prolonged period of low-intensity warfare against the Pallavas and other smaller kings such as the Brihadbanas of Kolar region, he proclaimed independence. Unable to contain Mayurasharma, the Pallavas had to accept his sovereignty. The Talaganda inscription also confirms Mayurasharma was the progenitor of the kingdom. The inscription gives a graphic description of the happenings after the Kanchi incident. That the hand dexterous in grasping the kusha grass, fuel and stones, ladle, melted butter and the ablation vessel, unsheathed a flaming sword, eager to conquer the earth. Thus, according to Ramesh, in an act of righteous indignation was born the first native kingdom of Karnataka, and the Pallava king Skandavarman condescended to recognize the growing might of the Kadambas south of the Malaprabha river as a sovereign power. Majumdar, however, feels even an inscription as important as the Talaganda pillar inscription leaves many a detail unanswered. Scholars such as Mauryas and Sastri opine that Mayurasharma may have availed himself of the confusion in the south that was created by the invasion of Samudragupta, who in his Allahabad inscription claims to have defeated Pallava king Vishnugopa of Kanchi. Taking advantage of the weakening of the Pallava power, Mayurasharma appears to have succeeded in establishing a new kingdom. According to epigraphist M. H. Krishna, Mayurasharma further subdued minor rulers such as the Trikutas, the Apiras, the Pariathrakas, the Shakastanas, the Makaris, the Punadas and the Sendrakas. The fact that Mayurasharma had to travel to distant Kanchi for Vedic studies gives an indication that Vedic lore was quite rudimentary in the Banavasi region at that time. The Gudnapur inscription, which was discovered by epigraphist B. R. Gopal, states that Mauryasharma, whose grandfather and preceptor was Virasharma and his father was Bandhashena, developed the character of a Kshatriya. Sen feels the successor of Mayurasharma, Kankavarma, changed his surname from Sharma to Varma. Expansion. Mayurasharma was succeeded by his son Kankavarma in circa 365. He had to fight the Vakataka might to protect his kingdom. According to Juvo Dubroy, he was defeated by the king Prithvisena but managed to maintain his freedom. Majumdar feels Kankavarma battled with King Vidyasena of the Basin branch of the Vakataka kingdom with no permanent results. His son Bajirath, who came to power in circa 390, is said to have retrieved his father's losses. According to Kamat, the Talaganda inscription describes Bajirath as the sole lord of the Kadamba land and the great Sagara himself, indicating he may have retrieved their losses against the Vakatakas. But contemporary though Vakataka inscriptions do not confirm this. His son Rigu died fighting the Pallavas in circa 435, though some inscriptions claim he secured the kingdom for his family. He was succeeded by his younger brother Kakusthavarma in circa 435. Kakusthavarma was the most powerful ruler of the dynasty. According to Sastri and Mauryas, under the rule Kakusthavarma, the kingdom reached its pinnacle of success and the Talaganda record calls him the ornament of the family. The Halasi and Halmidi inscriptions also hold him in high esteem. From the Talaganda inscription, it is known that he maintained marital relations with even such powerful ruling families as the imperial Guptas of the northern India. One of his daughters was married to King Madhava of the Ganga dynasty. According to the Desai, one of his daughters was married to Kumara Gupta's son Skandagupta, and from Balagat inscription of Vakataka King Prithvisena, we know another daughter called Ajitapatarika was married to the Vakataka prince Narendrasena. He maintained similar relations with the Batari vassal and the Alupas of South Kanara. According to Desai and Panchamukhi, evidence from Sanskrit literature indicates that during this time the notable Sanskrit poet Kalidasa visited the Kadamba court. Mauryas and Sen feel the visit happened during the reign of Bajirath. According to Sen, Kalidasa was sent by Chandragupta to Virakmaditya to conclude a marriage alliance with the Kadambas. His successor Santivarma was known for his personal charm and beauty. According to an inscription, he wore three crowns to display his prosperity, thus attracting the attention of his enemies, the Pallavas. When the Pallava threat loomed, he divided his kingdom in circa 455 and let his younger brother Krishnavarma rule over the southern portion and deal with the Pallavas. The branch is called the Triparvata branch and ruled from either Devagiri in the modern Dharwad district or Halabiju. Majumdar considers Krishnavarma's rule as somewhat obscure due to lack of his inscriptions, though the records issued by his sons credit him with efficient administration and an Ashvamedha. It is known that he possibly lost his life in battle with the Pallavas. According to the Hebada record, his successor and son Vishnuvarma had to accept the suzerainty of the Pallavas despite showing initial allegiance to his uncle Santivarma ruling from Banavasi, whom he described in an earlier record as lord of the entire Karnataka country. In circa 485, his son Simavarma came to power but maintained a low-profile relationship with Banavasi. In the northern part of the kingdom, Santivarma's brother Shiva Mandhatri ruled from circa 460 for more than a decade. In circa 475, Santivarma's son Rajshavarma came to the throne and faced the Pallavas and Gangas with considerable success. The Halasi plates describes him the destroyer of the eminent family of the Gangas and the destructive fire to the Pallavas. His queen Prabhavati of the Kekaya family bore him a son called Ravavarma. Mridshavarma was known to be a scholar and an expert in riding horses and elephants. After Kakusthavarma, only Ravavarma was able to build the kingdom back to its original might during a long rule lasting up to circa 519. Numerous inscriptions from his rule, starting from 5th up to the 35th regnal years, give a vivid picture of his successes, which was marked by a series of clashes within the family, and also against the Pallavas and the Gangas. He is credited with a victory against the Vakatakas as well. A Mahadeva temple constructed during his rule finds mention in a Greek writing of the period. According to the Gudnapur inscription, lesser rulers such as the Punadas, the Alupas, the Kongalvas and the Pandayas of Uchangi were dealt with successfully. The crux of the kingdom essentially consisted of significant areas of the Deccan, including large parts of modern Karnataka. King Ravavarma of the Banavasi branch killed King Vishnuvarma of the Triparvata branch according to Mauryas, and successfully dealt with the rebelling successors of Shiva Mandhatri at Uchangi. The Pallava king Chandadanda also met the same fate according to Sathyanathir. Ravavarma left two of his brothers, Banuvarma and Shivaratha, to govern from Halasi and Uchangi. Decline. After Ravavarma's death, he was succeeded by his peaceful son Harivarma in circa 519 according to the Sangoli inscription. According to the Banahalli plates, Harivarma was killed by resurgent Krishnavarma II of the Triparvata branch around circa 530 when he raided Banavasi, thus uniting the two branches of the kingdom. Around circa 540, the Chalukyas, who were vassals of the Kadambas and governed from Badami, conquered the entire kingdom. The Kadambas thereafter became vassals of the Badami Chalukyas. In later centuries, the family fragmented into numerous minor branches and ruled from Goa, Halasi, Hangal, Vainad, Belur, Vankapura, Vandalike, Chandavar and Jayantapura. That the Kadambas of Banavasi were a prosperous kingdom is attested to by the famous Ihole inscription of the Chalukyas, which describes Banavasi in these terms: resembling the city of gods and a girdle of swans, playing on the high waves of the river Virata. Administration. The Kadamba kings, like their predecessors the Satavahanas, called themselves Dharma Maharajas and followed them closely in their administrative procedures. The kings were well-read, and some were even scholars and men of letters. Inscriptions describe the founding king Mayurasharma as Vedangavadi Sharada. Vishnuvarma was known for his proficiency in grammar and logic, and Simavarma was called skilled in the art of learning. This wisdom and knowledge from the ancient Hindu texts all provided guidance in governance. Mauryas identified several important positions in the government: the prime minister, steward of household, secretary of council, scholarly elders, physician, private secretary, chief justice above whom was the king himself, other officials, revenue officers and the writers and scribes. The Gavundas formed the elite landowners, who were the intermediaries between the king and the farmers, collecting taxes, maintaining revenue records and providing military support to the royal family. The army consisted of officers such as Jagadala, Dandanayaka, and Senapati. The organization was based on the strategy called Charangabala. Guerrilla warfare was not unknown and may have been used often to gain tactical advantage. A crown prince from the royal family often helped the king in central administration at the royal capital. Some governed in the far-off provinces. This experience not only provided future security and know-how for the king-to-be, but also kept administration controls within trusted family members. This is seen in the case of Kings Shantivarma, Kakusthavarma, and Krishnavarma. King Kakusthavarma had appointed his son Krishnavarma as viceroy of Triparvata region. King Ravavarma's brothers Banu and Shivaratha governed over Halasi and Uchangi provinces respectively. Some regions continued to be under hereditary ruling families such as the Alupas, the Sendrakas, the Kekiyas and the Bataris. While Banavasi was the nerve center of power, Halasi, Triparvata and Uchangi were important regional capitals. The kingdom was divided into provinces. Under a province was a district, nine of which have been identified by Panchamukhi. Under a district was a taluk comprising numerous villages, under which were the villages in groups of 10. The smallest unit was the village, which appears to have enjoyed particular freedoms under the authority of headmen. Apart from the various divisions and subdivisions of the kingdom, there was a concept of urban settlement. The 5th century Burr copper plate inscription of King Vishnuvarma describes Banavasi as the ornament of Karnada Desa, adorned with 18 mandapikas, indicating it was a major trade center at that time. Numerous inscriptions make reference to the rulers at Banavasi as excellent lords of the city. Excavations have revealed that Banavasi was a settlement even during the Satavahana period. By the 5th century, it was a fortified settlement in the Kadamba capital. A later inscriptions of circa 692 of the Chalukyas refer to Banavasi and its corporate body as a witness to the granting of a village to a Brahmin by the monarch. A reference to the mercantile class further indicates the commercial importance of Banavasi. 1/6 of land produce was collected as tax. Other taxes mentioned in inscriptions were the levy on land, social security tax paid to the royal family, sales tax, land tax, beadle tax and professional taxes on traders such as oilmen, barbers and carpenters. Inscriptions mention many more taxes such as internal taxes, tax on eleemosynary holdings, presents to kings and cash payments. The capital Banavasi had 18 custom houses that levied taxes on incoming goods. In recognition of military or protective service provided by deceased warriors, the state made social service grants that supported their family. In addition to erecting a hero stone which usually included an inscription extolling the virtues of the hero, the grant would be in the form of land. Such land grant could be as small as a plot, as large as several villages, or even a large geographical unit depending on the hero's status. Economy. Inscriptions and literature are the main source of information about the economy and the factors that influenced it. According to Adiga, from studies conducted by historians and epigraphists such as Krishna, Kalburgi, Kittle, Rice, B.R. Gopal and Setter, it is clear the kingdom depended on revenues from both agricultural and pastoral elements. Numerous inscriptions, mainly from the modern Shimoga, Bijapur, Belgaum, Dharwad and Uttara Kannada regions mention cattle raids, cowherds and shepherds. The numerous hero stones to those who fought in cattle raids was an indication of not only lawlessness but also of the importance of herding. The mention of the terms Gasai, Gasasa, Gasasi and Gasahasara in the adjective, the imposition of taxes on milk and milk products, the existence of large cattle herds and the gifting of 1,000 cows as a mark of the donor's affluence indicate cow herding was an important part of the economy. There are records that mention the shepherd settlements, cowherd settlements and numerous references to small hamlets. Mixed farming, a combination of grazing and cultivation, mostly controlled by the wealthy Gavunda peasantry, seems to be the thing to do, for both the quantum of grain produced and number of cattle had determined opulence. There are several records that mention the donation of both grazing and cultivable land in units of kalagas or khandagas to either those who fought cattle thieves or to their families. A nomadic way of life is not prevalent in most communities, with the exception of hill tribes called Bettas. A semi-nomadic community, according to Durrett, they frequently depended on cattle thieving from outlying farms and the abduction of women. The Bettas subsisted by selling to merchants stolen cattle and such produce from the forest as meat, sandalwood and timber, and crops from disorganized agriculture. From inscriptions, three types of land are evident: wet or cultivable land usually used to cultivate paddy or a tall stout grain-yielding grass called sehye, dry land and garden land. A 6th century grant refers to garden land that grew sugarcane. Other crops that were also cultivated were barley, arika nut, fallow millet, wheat, pulses. Flowers were mostly for temple use and such lands called pundota. Fruits such as plantains and coconuts are also mentioned. Village descriptions in lithic and copper plate records, such as the Hyarsay Kuna 6th century copper plates from Soroba, included its natural bounding landmarks, layout of agricultural fields, repairs to existing and newly constructed water tanks, irrigation channels and streams, soil type and the crops grown. Repairs to tanks and construction of new ones was a preoccupation of elite, from kings to the Mahayanas, who claimed partial land ownership or a percentage of produce irrigated from the tank or both. Taxes were levied on newly irrigated lands, an indication the rulers actively encouraged the conversion of dry land to cultivable wet land. An important distinction is made between types of land holdings, Brahmadiya and non-Brahmadiya, and this is seen in inscriptions as early as the 3rd-4th century in South India. Records such as the Shikharipura Talic inscription indicate occasionally women were village headmen and counselors, and held land. Functioning purely on the excess produce of the rural hinterland were the urban centers, the cities and towns that often find mention in Kannada classics such as Vatiradhan and Pampa Burada. References to townships with specialized classes of people such as the diamond and cloth merchants and their shops, merchant guilds, important temples of worship and religious hubs, palaces of the royalty, vassals and merchants, fortifications, courtesan streets, and grain merchants and their markets are a clear indication that these urban entities were the centers of administrative, religious and economic activity. Culture. Religion. The end of the Satavahana rule in the 3rd century coincided with the advent of two religious phenomena in the Deccan and South India, the spread of Brahminical Hinduism, and Jainism and Buddhism. This was a direct result of the Gupta dynasty's ardent patronage to Hinduism in northern India and their aversion to other religions. According to Sastry, till about the 5th century, South India witnessed a harmonious growth of these religions and the sects related to them without hindrance. Appeasement of local deities and local practices which included offerings of sacrifices often went alongside popular Vedic gods such as Muruga, Shiva, Vishnu, and Krishna. However, from the 7th century onward, the growing popularity of Jainism and Buddhism became a cause for concern to the Hindu saints who saw the growth of these new faiths as heretic to mainstream Hinduism. This newfound Hindu resurgence, especially in Tamil country, was characterized by public debates and enthusiastic rebuttals by itinerant saints. Their main purpose was to energize and revive Hindu bhakti among the masses and bring back followers of sects considered primitive, such as the Kalamakas, Kapalikas, and Pasupadas, into mainstream Hinduism. The Kadambas were followers of Vedic Hinduism as evidenced by their inscriptions. The situation was the same with their immediate neighbors, the Gangas and the Pallavas. According to Adiga, their patronage to Brahmins well-versed in the Vedas is all too evident. Inscriptions narrate various land grants to Brahmins that specify their lineage as well as Vedic specialization. According to Sarkar, the early rulers called themselves Brahmanya or Parama Brahmanya, an indication of their propensity toward Vaishnavism. The founding king Mayurasharma was, according to the Talaganda inscription, a Brahmin by birth though his successors may have assumed the surname Varma to indicate their change to Kshatriya status. An inscription of Vishnuvarma describes him as the protector of the excellent Brahmana faith. His father Krishnavarma I performed the Vedic Ashvamedha. There are numerous records that record grants made to Brahmins. According to Sarkar, some 5th and 6th century inscriptions have an invocation of Hari Hara Hiranyagarbha and Hara Narayana Braham. The Talaganda inscription starts with an invocation of the Hindu god Shiva while the Halmidi and Banavasi inscriptions start with an invocation of the god Vishnu. Madhukshvara was their family deity and numerous donations were made to the notable Madhukshvara temple in Banavasi. Inscriptions mention various Shaiva sects such as Gauravas, Kapalikas, Pasupadas, and Kalamakas. Famous residential schools of learning existed in Balagavi and Talaganda. Vedic education was imparted in places of learning called Agrahara and Ghataka. However, they were tolerant to other faiths. The Kadamba kings appear to have encouraged Jainism as well. Some records of King Rudshayavarma indicate described donations to Jain temples and that King Ravavarma held a Jain scholar in high esteem. Names of such noted Jain preceptors as Pujayapada, Niravadi Pandita and Kumaradatta find mention in their inscriptions. Jainas occupied commanding posts of importance in their armies. According to Adiga, image worship, which was originally prohibited, was now popularized among the common man and the monks. This helped raise funds for the construction of Jain temples. Installation of images of Jain monks in temples and a steady move toward ritualistic worship among the laymen undermined the concept of quest for salvation and the ascetic vigor of the religion. Grants were made to Buddhist centers as well. According to Kamat, the royal capital Banavasi had long been a place of Buddhist learning. In the 7th century, the Chinese embassy Haiyan Song described Banavasi as a place of 100 Sangharamas where 10,000 scholars of both the Mahayana and Hinayana Buddhism lived. However, according to Ray, while there is evidence to prove that certain pre-Kadamba royal families, such as the Mauryas and Shutus may have patronized Buddhism, there is not much to say regarding the ruling Kadamba family, vast majority of whose inscriptions are Brahminical grants. In fact, according to Ray, the traces of Buddhist stupa sites that have been discovered in Banavasi are located outside the town, society. The caste system was prevalent in the organized Hindu society with the Brahmins and the Kshatriyas at the top. This had a deep impact on such socially important events as marriage. Even Jainism and Buddhism, which initially found popularity by avoiding social hierarchy, began to develop the trappings of a caste-based society. This particular feature was, according to Singh, a unique feature of Jainism in what is modern-day Karnataka during the early medieval period. Both the sects of Jainism, The Digambara and the Svetambara followed a strict qualification process for persons worthy of initiation. Yina Sanya's classic Adipurana counts purity of ancestry, physical health and soundness of mind as the main attributes that made a person worthy of such initiation. Both Yina Sanya and Ravasena discuss the existence of a Varna-based society and the responsibilities of each Varna. Majumdar notes that the Buddhist and Jain literature of the period accounts for the four Varna by placing the Kshatriya above the Brahmin. While the Brahminical literature points to a tradition that permitted a Brahmin man to marry a woman of Kshatriya caste, a Brahmin woman was not allowed to marry a non-Brahmin man. Just the contrary seems to be the case with Buddhist and Jain literature, which deem the marriage of a Brahmin man to Kshatriya woman as unacceptable, but that of a Kshatriya man to a Brahmin woman is acceptable. Thus a caste system was in play with all the three main religions of the times. However, Majumdar does point out the highly assimilate nature of the Hindu society, where all the early invaders into India, such as the Kushans, the Greeks, the Sakas and the Parthians, were all absorbed into the Hindu society without a trace of their earlier practices. A unique feature of medieval Indian society was the commemoration of the deceased hero by the erection of memorial stones. These stones, the inscriptions and relief sculptures on them, were meant to deify the fallen hero. According to Upendra Singh, the largest concentration of such stones, numbering about 2,650 and dated to between the 5th and 13th centuries, are found in the modern Karnataka region of India. While most were dedicated to men, a few interesting ones are dedicated to women and pets. The Siddenahalli, the Kembalu and the Shikaripura hero stones extol the qualities of women who lost their lives fighting cattle rustlers or enemies. The Galarhati and the Attakur inscription are in memory of a dog that died fighting wild boar, and the Tambor inscription of a Kadamba king of the Goa branch describes his death from sorrow of losing his pet parrot to a cat, and the Kupachur stone was in memory of a bonded servant who was given the honorific slayer of the enemy for bravely fighting and killing a man-eater tiger with his club before succumbing to his injuries. According to Altaker, the practice of sati appears to have been adopted well after the Vedic period, because there was no sanction for the practice in the funeral hymns of the Rig Veda. According to him, even in the Atharva Veda, there is only a passing reference of widow being required to lie by the side of her husband's corpse on the funeral pyre, then alight from it before it was lit, for the chanting of hymns to commence that blessed her with future wealth and children. This was an indication that widow remarriage was in vogue. Altaker points out that even the authors of the Dharmasutras and the Smritas, such as Manu and Yajnavalkya, do not make any mention of any ritual resembling sati in their description of the duties of women and widows in society, but rather prescribe the path of worldly renunciation as worthy. It is from about circa 400 that the practice of sati begins to appear in the literature of Vatsyayana, Vasa, Kalidasa and Shudraka, with a real case in circa 510 when deceased General Paraja's wife immolated herself on her husband's pyre. Then around 606, the mother of King Harshavardhana decided to predecease her terminally ill husband. This, however, did not find immediate support with noted poets such as Bana and other Tantra writers who considered sati inhuman and immoral. However, around circa 700, the tide began to turn in northern India, especially in Kashmir, but found a later stronghold in Rajasthan. The belief in sati began to appeal, especially to the warrior classes, and the theory that performing sati cleansed the deceased husband of earthly sins and assured the couple a place in heaven caught on. Occasionally, concubines, mothers, sisters, sisters-in-law and even ministers, servants and nurses joined in the act. This took its time to reach the Deccan and the Deep South, where the earliest cases, voluntary as they were, are seen by about circa 1000. What was once a Kshatriya-only practice came to be adopted by the Brahmins and even some Jains from around circa 1000. In the modern Karnataka region, there are only 11 cases between circa 1000 circa 1441 cases between circa 1400 to circa 1600, mostly in the warrior communities, indicating an overall lack of appeal. Physical education was very popular with men. The book Agni Purana encouraged men to avoid calisthenics with either partially digested food in their body or on a full stomach. Bathing with cold water after exercises was considered unhealthy. Medieval sculptures depict youth in physical combat training, doing gymnastics such as lifting the weight of the body with both hands, and doing muscular exercises such as bending a crowbar. The terms mala and yadi occur often in literature, indicating wrestling was a popular sport with the royalty and the commoners. Wrestlers of both genders existed, the women fighters meant purely for the entertainment to a male audience. Several kings had titles such as Ahavamala, Tribhuvanamala. The book Akayanaka Manakosa refers to two types of combative sports, the Mushyuddha and Mallayuddha. Wrestlers were distinguished based on their body weight, age, skill, proficiency and stamina. Those who exemplified themselves were recognized and maintained on specific diets. Much of the information we get about activities such as archery and hunting is from classics such as the Agni Purana and others. The Agni Purana says one who has made the vision of both of his mental and physical eyes steady can conquer even the god of death. An archer's proficiency, which depended as much on his footwork as on his fingers and keen eyesight, was proven if he could hit bullseye by just looking down at the target's reflection. Additional information is available in medieval sculptures which depict various archery scenes, including one where a lady is taking aim from a chariot. Hunting was a favorite pastime of royalty in forest preserves. It served as entertainment, physical exercise, and a test of endurance. The medieval sculptors spared no effort in depicting hunting scenes. The Manasalasa describes 21 types of hunt, including ambushing deer at waterholes with the hunting party dressed in green and concealed in the hollows of trees. It mentions a special breed of hunting dogs chosen from places such as the modern Jalandhar, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Vidarbha, which were preferred for their stamina in chasing and cornering the prey. According to the Vikraman Katavakarita, queens and courtesans accompanied the king on horseback. Architecture. According to Kamat, the Kadambas are the originators of the Karnataka architecture. According to Mauryas, their architectural style had a few things in common with the Pallava style. Kamat points out that their Vimana style is a Kadamba invention. A good example of this construction is seen in the Shankaradeva temple at Kadaroli in the modern Belgaum district. The structures themselves were simplistic, with a square garbhagraha with an attached larger hall called mantapa. The superstructure over the sanctum is pyramidal with horizontal non-decorative step stages tipped at the pinnacle with a kalasha. The beginnings of Kadamba architecture can be traced to the 4th century based on evidence in the Talaganda pillar inscription of circa 450. The inscription makes mention of a Mahadeva temple of the Stanagandura Grihara, which Adiga identifies with the protected monument, the Pranishvara temple at Talaganda. The Pranishvara temple bears inscriptions of Queen Prabhavati from the late 5th century and of their son King Ravavarma. From these inscriptions, Adiga concludes the temple existed in the late 4th century. Further, according to Adiga, the pillar inscription supports the claim that the earliest structure existed there as early as the 3rd century and was under the patronage of the Shutu Satakarnis of Banavasi. Most of their extant constructions are seen in Halasi and surrounding areas, with the oldest one ascribed to King Rudshavarma. Other notable temples in Halasi include the Hadaksavara temple with perforated screens by the doors, the Kalsvara temple with octagonal pillars, the Bhuvaraha Narasimha temple, and the Ramasvara temple, which shows a Sukhanasa projection over the vestibule that connects the sanctum to the hall. All temples at Halasi have pillars with decorative capitals. The Kadamba style of tower was popular several centuries later and are seen in the Lakshmi Devi temple at Dadagadavali and the Himakuta group of temples in Hampi built in the 14th century. In addition to temples, according to the art historian K.B. Sudara Rajan, the Kadambas created three rock-cut Vedic cave temples cut out of laterite at Arvalam in Goa. Like their temples, the caves too have an ardham on top of with plain pillars and a sanctum which contain images of Surya, Shiva and Skanda. In later centuries, Kadamba architecture was influenced by the ornate architectural style of their overlords, the Kalyani Chalukyas. The best representations of this style are seen in the Mahadeva temple at Tamdi Surla in modern Goa, built with an open mantapa in the late 12th-13th century by the Kadambas of Goa, the single shrine Tarakeshvara temple built prior to circa 1180 with an open mantapa, a closed mantapa, a linked gateway and an Anandi mantapa, the Madhukshwara temple at Banavasi, which shows several later Chalukya style additions over a pre-existing early Chalukya surroundings, and the 12th century, three-shrined Kadamshvara temple with open and closed mantapa at Ratihali. Language. According to the epigraphist D.C. Sarkar, inscriptions have played a vital role in the reconstruction of history of literature in India as well as the political history of the kingdoms during the early centuries of the first millennium. Some inscriptions mention names of noted contemporary and earlier poets. The development of versification and the Kavya style of poetry appears first in inscriptions before making their appearance in literature. Further, some Kavya poets were the authors of inscriptions too. In the early centuries of the first millennium, inscriptions in the Deccan were predominantly in the Prakrit language. Then came a slow change with records appearing in bilingual Sanskrit Prakrit languages around the middle of the 4th century, where the genealogy information is in Sanskrit while the functional portion was in Prakrit. From around the 5th century, Prakrit fell out of use entirely and was replaced by the Dravidian languages. In the Kannada-speaking regions in particular, the trend was to inscribe in Sanskrit entirely or in Sanskrit Kannada. The credit of the development of Kannada as a language of inscriptions between the 4th and 6th centuries goes to the Kadambas, the Gangas and the Badami Chalukyas. Among the early ones are the Halmidi stone inscription and the Tagar copper plates which are ascribed to the Kadambas. While the main content of the inscriptions were in Sanskrit, the boundary specifications of the land grant were in Kannada. In subsequent 2 centuries, not only do inscriptions become more numerous and longer in size, these inscriptions show a significant increase in the usage of Kannada, though the invocatory, the implicatory and the panegyric verses are in Sanskrit. Setter points out that there are inscriptions where the implicatory verses have been translated verbatim into Kannada also. In fact, Kannada composed in verse meters start making their appearance in inscriptions even before being committed to literature. Inscriptions in Sanskrit and Kannada are the main sources of the Kadamba history. The Talagunda, Gudnapur, Burrur, Shimoga, Mutter, Habata, Chandravalli, Halasi and Halmidi inscription are some of the important inscriptions that throw light on this ancient ruling family of Karnataka. Inscriptions of the Kadambas in Sanskrit and Kannada ascribed to Kadamba branches have been published by epigraphists Sarkar, Desai, Guy and Rao of the Archaeological Survey of India. The Kadambas minted coins, some of which have Kannada legends which provide additional numismatic evidence of their history. The Kadambas were the first rulers to use Kannada as an additional official administrative language, as evidenced by the Halmidi inscription of circa 450. The historian Kamat claims Kannada was the common language of the region during this time. While most of their inscriptions are in Sanskrit, 3 important Kannada inscriptions from the rule of the early Kadambas of Banavasi have been discovered. Recent reports claim that the discovery of a 5th-century Kadamba copper coin in Banavasi with Kannada script inscriptions from Anuragi indicating that a mint may have existed in Banavasi that produced coins with Kannada legends at that time. The discovery of the Talagunda lion balustrade inscription at the Pranishvara temple during excavations in 2013, and its publication by the ASI in 2016, has shed more light on the politics of language during the early Kadamba era. The bilingual inscription of circa 370-380 written in Sanskrit and Kannada is now though to be the oldest inscription in the Kannada language. In modern times, Kadambozava is a festival that is celebrated every year by the government of Karnataka in honor of this kingdom. The creation of the first native Kannada kingdom is celebrated by a popular Kannada film, Mayura starring Raj Kumar. It is based on a popular novel written in 1933 with the same name by Devudu Narasimha Sastri. On May 31, 2005, Defense Minister of India Pranab Mukherjee commissioned India's most advanced and first dedicated military naval base named INS Kadamba in Karwar. The Indian state government of Goa-owned bus service is named after the Kadambas dynasty and is known as Kadamba Transport Corporation. The royal lion emblem of the Kadambas is used a logo on its buses. The lion emblem logo became an integral part of KTCL since its inception in 1980 when the corporation was set up to provide better public transport service.